Dr. David Priess obtained his PhD in political science from Duke University, and he's published various articles and book reviews for journals and magazines. He's worked as an intelligence officer, a manager, and a daily intelligence briefer for the Central Intelligence Agency. And he also served as a desk officer at the State Department and has taught numerous international relations classes at Duke University, George Washington University, and George Mason University. He's an accomplished presenter. He's spoken to audiences ranging from presidents of the United States to millions of viewers via national media such as Fox News and CNN. He's now the director of analytic services for Analytic Advantage, offering specialized training, mentoring, and consulting services to government and private sector clients on critical thinking and effective presentation techniques. And he's also the author of a new book. It's called The President's Book of Secrets, The Untold Story of Intelligence Briefings to America's Presidents from Kennedy to Obama, which contains 50 years of stories about the President's daily brief and carries a foreword from President George H.W. Bush. For the book, Priess received unique input directly from every living former president and vice president, as well as vast majority of former CIA directors, national security advisors, secretaries of state and defense, White House chiefs of staff, and other national security leaders. So it's a pretty, it's a monument of research and intellect. So without further ado, ladies and gentlemen, Dr. David Priess.
Thank you, Jonathan. Thank you, everyone, for coming out and listening to this tonight. Special thanks to the Nixon Foundation and the Nixon Library for sponsoring this and hosting this. I thank you for your hospitality and for this setting. Isn't this amazing? They built this replica of the East Room just for this event, just for us. That's what your staff told me. Tonight, you're going to hear stories about top secret intelligence and stories about the presidents who received that top secret intelligence. These tales most often do come from the presidents themselves and from the people who served the presidents directly, as Jonathan mentioned. I did work at CIA. I did write top secret intelligence reports for presidents. I did brief the most sensitive intelligence, but this is not a memoir. I'm carrying forward the stories of those presidents, vice presidents, and others to give a sense of the history that goes behind the top secret intelligence and the presidents who then receive it. I'll be telling you a little bit about the evolution of the most exclusive daily publication in the world, the President's Daily Brief. It has now existed for more than 60 years, and I'll walk you through a little bit of the stories behind it, some of the tales of how its production and delivery and reception have changed over the years, depending on the personality of each president. And that's really what you'll hear tonight, is a unique window on the presidents and on their personalities based on the way this product has been tailored to their individual needs. I'll talk about each of the presidents in the modern era with a little special focus on a man named Richard Nixon. But we'll go back a few years first. To start to talk about modern American intelligence, we have to mention Franklin Delano Roosevelt. He was the first president to receive what we would today call any intelligence at all to help him make foreign policy decisions. In his case, it was for World War II. He started getting information from what was then called the Office of Strategic Services, or the OSS. This was not the kind of finished intelligence reporting, the deep assessments, the very carefully thought through logic and writing that we see in the modern era. But he was getting actual intelligence for the first time on a steady basis. Now that changed under his predecessor, Harry Truman. No longer a war to prosecute after the Japanese surrendered, but Harry Truman saw the need for a permanent intelligence service in the United States. He created the Central Intelligence Agency and soon thereafter started getting what was called the Daily Summary, which was the first daily product delivered to the president summarizing various things about intelligence. Now, it did not include all intelligence sources. It did not go into much depth. You look at some of the declassified examples of it, and they are relatively light, but it did start the process. That process continued with Dwight Eisenhower as well. But the story of modern presidential intelligence really does start with John F. Kennedy. John Kennedy came into office with a decidedly different approach to decision-making than his predecessor, Dwight Eisenhower liked a series of stately meetings, one after another one, planned weeks or even months in advance on topics, regardless of what was going on in the world. They knew that 2 months from today, there was going to be a committee meeting on Italy, and they would proceed with papers and things to support that. Kennedy did not play that way. Kennedy wanted to engage in a more ad hoc way. He wanted to engage on topics as they came up. He was also habitually unable to sit still. And his advisors found they could not sit him down for a dedicated briefing and expect him to sit there for 10, 20 minutes and listen to it all. Similarly, they would hand him these long government reports full of deep intelligence and rich information, and they would find that they just sat there unread. In one case, he even asked one of his advisors, looking at this stack of daily intelligence documents, "Do I really have to read it all?" They decided this just wasn't going to work. His military aide, who provided him this daily intelligence every morning, called in two senior officers from the Central Intelligence Agency and said, "Here's what I need you to do." He started pulling out report after report that he was getting from CIA, from the Defense Department, from the State Department, and from various other government agencies that all competed for the president's attention and his. The two CIA officers were astounded because the stack kept growing. And he said, "This is what I have to deal with. What I want you to do for me is I want you to create one product for the president that tells him everything he needs to know from all of this and nothing that he doesn't need to know. And we'd like it in a style that's more readable than this bureaucratic gobbledygook with all these classification markings and headers and footers. And could you also print it in a way that he can carry it around with him during the day? Because he's not going to sit still and read the whole thing. He's going to want to carry it with him and then read it whenever he has a break between meetings." And one of the CIA officers was smirking because he had been thinking about just such a thing. Ever since Eisenhower left, Kennedy started, he'd been talking to his colleagues back at CIA about how they needed to meet the personality and needs of the new president. The very next day, unheard of in Washington circles today with the bureaucracy, but the very next day, the CIA had a draft of it for the military aide. The day after that, they gave it to Kennedy. It was a small booklet, something he could fold, put into his suit coat pocket, and carried around with him during the day. They called it the President's Intelligence Checklist. Like everything else in Washington, it becomes an acronym. The PICL immediately began being pronounced as the pickle. Kennedy loved it. He would carry it around. There are plenty of memos showing that he would read it, and he would immediately task some of his officers to follow through on some of the national security and foreign policy aspects that it drove. There was a real problem with that, though. They weren't getting it. Kennedy was getting it. His national security advisor was getting it. The CIA director was getting it. That was it. You can imagine being the Secretary of State or Secretary of Defense, thinking you have a pretty important job, and you get the president calling you, asking you to follow through on something, and you have no idea why. So it was only a few months before they decided the Secretary of State, the Secretary of Defense also needed to get this product. But there was one man in a very important position in the administration who never got this product. And that became a real problem after a day in Dallas when Lyndon Johnson became President of the United States. He had no idea the President's Intelligence Checklist even existed. Kennedy and his staff had excluded him. The only time it had come close was when one of those very same CIA officers who'd created the product raised this with the Executive Secretary of the National Security Council. He said, "All of the statutory members of the National Security Council, the President, the Secretary of State, the Secretary of Defense, they're all getting this product, but the fourth member, the Vice President, is not. What about Lyndon Johnson?" And the answer was firm and final: under no circumstances. They did not want him to even see it. So that led to a very awkward morning, that very first morning when Johnson was back in Washington. The CIA director comes in and treats it like a regular intelligence briefing, handing him the president's intelligence checklist, starting to walk through it. Johnson didn't react. It was clear that he did not know it existed, but he didn't take out his anger on the CIA director. But he knew what was behind this. He knew this was not a new product they developed in the time between the assassination in Dallas the day before and that morning. He could piece it together. So it's no surprise that he did not take to this product. So, CIA adapted. And in 1964, they reformatted the book. They changed it a little bit in terms of its book, and they changed its title. And they gave a new product to Lyndon Johnson, something his aides could tell him was truly designed for him, called the President's Daily Brief, and that name and the basic concept has stuck. It is somewhere between 6 and 20 pages, depending on the day's news, of the top-level intelligence analysis, originally just from CIA, now from the entire intelligence community. The idea is that on various topics around the world that the president needs to know about, analysts will look at it all from classified sources, the CIA's spies, the National Security Agency's listening posts, satellite imagery, combine that with open material, like the open press, and come up with the story that needs to be told. What are the threats overseas that the president needs to be aware of and hopefully preempt? What are the opportunities overseas in foreign policy that the president can make a phone call to the leader right at the time when it's going to be most useful to get U.S. national security objectives accomplished? That's the goal of the president's daily brief. Most of those president's daily brief copies have been declassified now, and we can see what Lyndon Johnson was reading, and you can see why it appealed to him. Here's a very busy man. The schedule of the president of the United States is managed down to the minute. He doesn't have time for a lot of stuff he doesn't need. And sure enough, the language in the president's daily brief was written in an easy-to-digest format in a relatively colloquial style that included a lot of colorful language, much different than a typical government report. So Johnson liked it. He read it avidly. He seemed to appreciate it. So the CIA was pretty happy with itself for a few years. Then the administration changed. Richard Nixon came into office distrusting the CIA for a couple of major reasons. One, he still lingered some distrust over the 1960 election. He thought that the CIA had undermined him in the election by giving information to John F. Kennedy under the table. Whether it's true or not, that was his perception. Secondly, ideologically, he thought that the CIA was manned by a bunch of left-wing liberals from Ivy League universities that were out to get him. You combine those two, and you don't have a very receptive audience for this intelligence analysis. That perception of the views of especially the analysts at the Central Intelligence Agency was one that Henry Kissinger, soon to be his national security advisor, shared. Kissinger told me, "I thought the analytic branch was occasionally a subdivision of the New York Times editorial page." He said, biased very much to the liberal point of view. During the transition from Lyndon Johnson to Richard Nixon, the CIA set up a dedicated support hub just around the corner from Richard Nixon's transition headquarters in New York at the Hotel Pierre. It was unprecedented. They set up an office over one weekend, allowing them to get all this classified information, compile it, print it for the president, take it to his office so that he could get into the habit of reading this president's daily brief. And they could also brief his advisors as they were being named. Well, it was a little bit strange because all of a sudden over this weekend, there's a mysterious office with no sign on it, with all of this expensive equipment being moved in, and all these men in dark suits running from there to the Hotel Pierre. It probably drew more attention than if they had just put a sign on it saying Central Intelligence Agency. But because of this unwanted attention, a couple of interesting things happened. Residents of the building and some of Nixon's staff started asking this office's workers with help for things, because they thought these people could do anything. They were so secret and mysterious, after all. So they asked for help with diverse problems, like locating missing television sets, and even tasting canned hams that had been donated to Richard Nixon to celebrate his election victory, the King's Tasters. This office ended up briefing people like Dick Allen, the primary foreign policy advisor to Nixon during the campaign, who ended up as deputy national security advisor for a while to start out. They ended up briefing Henry Kissinger and others. But there was one person they never got to brief, and that was Richard Nixon. They never achieved a face-to-face meeting with the president-elect during this entire transition period. Not only that, but they were sending an envelope with the president's daily brief and other briefing materials every day to Nixon's office. Late in December, they realized they had been unopened. And sure enough, by the time the transition period ended, they had all the envelopes returned unopened. All of this effort, but to what end? As the administration started, that trend continued. Henry Kissinger became the main focal point for intelligence to President Nixon. In the files of the Nixon Library right here, I found a memo that shows that right at the beginning of the administration, Kissinger wanted to ensure that the president's daily brief was delivered to the White House the evening before it was supposed to be read by the president and the National Security Advisor. Why? He wanted to see what was in it. And he wanted to make sure that if there was something he disagreed with, that he would be prepared to answer the president's questions, to counter the points within that PDB article that he disagreed with. In some cases, maybe to put some other information there that would give a different picture to the president. It certainly delayed the information getting to the president. Now, during his administration, during some times, Larry Higby has said that, yeah, sometimes Nixon did get it that night, but certainly Henry Kissinger had a chance to look at it first. At first, Kissinger was not pleased with the president's daily brief. He thought that especially its global coverage was not going to suit the president well. This surprised the senior CIA officers who met with him to talk about his first reactions to this daily intelligence report. He asked them, "Do you have a daily quota for reports?" And they were confused and said, "Well, no, what do you mean?" He said, "Well, I'm reading in here something about Panama. I don't understand. Why are you paying attention to Panama?" And they explained the analyst's judgment that the political turmoil there was increasing and would eventually threaten U.S. national interests. And he said, "But if anything happens there, I'll just turn it over to the Assistant Secretary of State for the region." He said, "Our attention, the attention of Mr. Nixon and myself, is going to be centered on the Soviet Union and Europe." Interesting statement to start the administration. Within a few years, as we've just seen with the declassification and release of thousands of president's daily briefs from the Nixon and Ford administrations yesterday, the vast majority of the PDBs had articles on Southeast Asia, the Middle East, China, certainly not just the Soviet Union and Western Europe. Things change once you're actually dealing with the crises around the world instead of what you want to focus on. Henry Kissinger ended up becoming a pretty good customer for the intelligence business. He distrusted the analysts in many ways, but he read their product seriously. We don't have any direct evidence that Richard Nixon did. We do have circumstantial evidence that he did. Initially, Henry Kissinger said that he thought that Nixon frequently ignored the president's daily brief. When I spoke with him a few years ago, he recanted and said he was actually sure that he read it, and he gave me some reasons for believing so. There's also some good circumstantial reasoning. Richard Nixon, among other things, did not trust everybody. He liked having a check on information he was getting from multiple sources. Often that check was Henry Kissinger himself on national security affairs. But he did not trust Henry Kissinger either. And to have some objective, independent source of information on national security affairs to make sure that he was not being blindsided by Dr. Kissinger is exactly the kind of thing that Richard Nixon would have done. So I'm inclined to believe that he did read it in office. He never gave feedback, however, to the analysts producing it. So they don't know what Richard Nixon thought about the PDB. Other customers did receive the president's daily brief other than Richard Nixon and Henry Kissinger during the Nixon administration. From the beginning, the Secretary of Defense, the Secretary of State, the Chairman of the Joint Chiefs of Staff, and interestingly, the Attorney General of the United States, who normally does not have a prominent foreign policy and national security role. But this man was John Mitchell, one of Richard Nixon's closest advisors. John Mitchell started getting actual briefings every day. He would have a CIA officer come to him and talk through the material in the book and explain what was behind the judgments in the book, answer questions, etc. This led to some interesting exchanges because John Mitchell was not a forgiving man either. One of the best briefing stories from the Nixon administration is when a substitute briefer, filling in for the normal briefer, went to brief the Attorney General at the Justice Department. And there was a piece in there evaluating what had happened in an election in Malta. John Mitchell read the story, looked up, and said, "I've never seen you call one of these right," referring to making the election judgment. In fact, the previous day's PDB had called the Malta election right. But it was bad luck because this substitute briefer had not looked at the previous day's book. He had just grabbed that day's book and gone in to brief John Mitchell. He said something that he later regretted in response. Hearing, "I've never heard you call one of these right," he said back, "Well, we called the Allende election right," and he wished he hadn't done that because he was referring to the election in 1970 of Salvador Allende in Chile, an election which angered the Nixon administration, Nixon personally so much, that he eventually took efforts to try to overturn that elected government covertly. Not the thing that was going to make Mitchell happy. So Mitchell, in turn, hears, we called the Allende election right. And he snaps back, well, then why didn't you do something about it? Near the end of Nixon's term, somebody else came into the administration who actually changed the course of PDB history in a small but important way. The new vice president, Gerald Ford. He came into office, and at the beginning, he was not receiving the president's daily brief in an echo of what John F. Kennedy had done with Lyndon Johnson. But he came out to CIA headquarters for a tour. And the director of the Central Intelligence Agency actually had him walk around the building a little bit. He had meetings with him and gave him some briefings, but he walked him through some of the offices to say hi to the troops and to see what it was like. One of the offices he walked him through was called the Office of Current Intelligence. It was the part of the Central Intelligence Agency that at that time produced the president's daily brief and several lower level products that went to other levels of the US government. As they walked through, the president's daily brief just happened to be sitting on one of the tables. And they walked by and Gerald Ford said, well, what is that? And the director of Central Intelligence Agency said, well, that's the PDB. That's what goes to Mr. Nixon and Dr. Kissinger every morning. Would you like to see it? And Ford, of course, says, well, yeah, sure I would. And they make an arrangement whereby Ford not only starts getting the president's daily brief, but he starts getting a daily briefer himself, the first vice president who on a daily basis had a working level CIA officer come to his home and sit at his kitchen table with him and talk through the contents in this intelligence document. Now, this was unique, and it was a bit of a surprise to Henry Kissinger, who liked to control all things involving national security and intelligence. Reportedly, he was furious when he heard about this arrangement. But seeing the writing on the wall about what might happen in a few months, he did not object, and it's not clear whether his objection would have mattered, because Gerald Ford liked what he got. Fast forward a few months, and it's August 1974. Richard Nixon leaves office. Suddenly, the real estate for this president's daily briefing changes from the kitchen table in Alexandria, Virginia, to the Oval Office. The same briefer starts going from the CIA, but Ford decides, even as president, he's going to continue this. And he becomes the first president to take daily briefings of the PDB. And this continues for about a year. At that point, he feels up to speed enough on foreign policy that he feels that his meetings with national security advisors do the job well enough, and he stops seeing the briefer every day, but he still has him wait outside in case he has any questions. The next few presidents changed their delivery and the way they reacted to the president's daily brief in several ways. I'll walk through a few of them quickly, and then I'll save a lot of time for questions to see what presidents and personalities you're most interested in hearing about. Jimmy Carter came next. Jimmy Carter wanted a format of the president's daily brief that was a little unusual. He was somebody who loved to write. Even back when he was governor of Georgia, he would get memos and he would scrawl all over them, giving orders to his staff, asking questions. So they redesigned the PDB for him. They printed it with much wider margins, with lots of white space, so that in his scrawl, he could put his questions and everything else on it. And he did, but he did follow the model back to Kissinger's day. His national security advisor, Zbigniew Brzezinski, also dominated the delivery of intelligence to the president. In fact, when the new director of Central Intelligence started office, this was Stansfield Turner, an old Naval Academy classmate of the president's, he noticed that he was the president's top intelligence advisor, and yet the daily intelligence briefing was being done by the national security advisor at the White House. So he went to Zbigniew Brzezinski, pointed out how this didn't seem right to him. And so Brzezinski thought for a moment, took out his pen, went over to the president's schedule, crossed out the words intelligence briefing, and wrote in national security briefing. From that day on, he just incorporated the intelligence report into the national security briefing and said the situation's resolved. There is no intelligence briefing. Didn't work very well for Stansfield Turner, but he did get the next best thing. He got regular access to the President of the United States through weekly meetings, sometimes more than once a week, where he would go in and talk to Jimmy Carter, often one-on-one, usually with the National Security Advisor also attending. Ronald Reagan followed, and Ronald Reagan has a reputation for not taking his reading very seriously, certainly not top secret intelligence. The research tells a different tale. In fact, Ronald Reagan seems to have devoured his president's daily briefs. He did not take a briefer. He never saw a CIA daily working level briefer like Ford had done, but he would have the PDB included in his daily morning report with his national security advisor. How do we know that he read it? Well, we have a few signs. Number one, All the people I talked to who worked in the Reagan administration agreed. Yes, he read this. In fact, Reagan would read anything you gave him, and that was their real problem. They gave him a 30-page report, and they said, just read the intro. They would find notes and markings on all 30 pages. He felt he had to do his homework. Secondly, if you look at Reagan's extensive diaries, which I did, you will find that he makes several references throughout his administration to the PDB, or the President's Daily Brief, or to his daily intelligence report, in some cases remarking on the individual things within it. We also have a report from some of the historians at the Central Intelligence Agency who went into the classified vaults and pulled out all of the President's Daily Briefs that had been given to Ronald Reagan himself and returned for storage. And they found, on a significant percentage, they found actual markings. They found underlinings. They found question marks. In a few cases, embarrassingly, they found a few corrections where Reagan had seen things that were incorrect and pointed them out. So that's all evidence that Reagan took it seriously. But it wasn't until his successor, George H.W. Bush, that the intelligence briefings really came back. George H.W. Bush had been the director of Central Intelligence back for Gerald Ford. He had been vice president for 8 years. This was a man who knew intelligence and appreciated what it could do. He brought the briefer back in. He started having daily working level sessions with the CIA briefer, along with some of his senior advisors in the Oval Office. He did it for his whole administration, the first president to do so. Now, I was not surprised in talking to George H.W. Bush and talking to the vice president, the National Security Advisor, the Secretary of State, everyone in his administration. I was not surprised to learn that he took the intelligence seriously, that he used it carefully to help resolve the Iraqi invasion of Kuwait and to help resolve the end of the Cold War peacefully without a shot being fired. That didn't shock me. What did shock me was some of the liberties that he took with his briefings and the fact that he was so comfortable with his intelligence that he was willing to have a little bit of fun with it too. In one case, there was analysis in the President's Daily Brief about an election in Central America. The country of Nicaragua was having its first open and free elections. The analysis in the PDB, the analysts at the CIA predicted that the incumbent, Daniel Ortega, was going to win because he had all of the powers of incumbency behind him. President Bush read the analysis, looked up at his briefer, and said, "I'll bet you an ice cream cone that you're wrong." Briefer is shocked. This is not the normal thing that happens in intelligence briefings, I can tell you that. But what do? The President of the United States wants to make a wager with you. You take it. You defend the analysis in the book. And he says, okay. The next day, the briefer comes to the Oval Office with an ice cream cone. The President was right. The opposition won. Another thing that President Bush did is he wanted humor in the President's Daily Brief itself. Very serious topics. In some cases, life and death information is in this book. But that doesn't mean that he didn't appreciate a lighter touch. In fact, in one case, there was an article that was talking about the removal of Soviet armor from Eastern Germany after the end of the Cold War. And the title of the piece, appealing to Bush's sense of humor, was "Tanks for the Memories." Nobody said intelligence officers were comedians. The successor to George Bush was, of course, Bill Clinton. Bill Clinton had a real ebb and flow with his PDB. He was constitutionally unable to stay on time in meetings. And this led to a real problem for his briefers, because they would come in, they would be ready to brief him, and then they'd get delayed. The National Security Advisor would poke his head out and say, "I'm sorry, I know we were supposed to do this for half an hour, but you've got 5 minutes. Or more often, as time went on, "I'm sorry, we're not going to have time for this. Can you just leave it with us?" And so it ended up being a process where it wasn't sure if the briefer would get in or not. For some of his administration, the briefer did get in. In fact, CIA Director John Brennan, today's CIA director, was one of the briefers who regularly got in to see Bill Clinton with the PDB when he was a briefer back in the 1990s. But Bill Clinton did take it seriously, whether he was briefed on it or whether he read it. And he told me some stories of when it really impacted history. In one case, he credits it for helping to avoid nuclear Armageddon. That's impact. He said that in 1997, India and Pakistan, perhaps 1999, I'll check the facts, India and Pakistan were having a conflict along their mutual border. And both of these countries were now nuclear powers. This was not going to end well. He read something in his President's Daily Brief about the fact that India and Pakistan did not appear to have perfect information about each other's intentions nor capabilities. That very day, he was meeting with the Prime Minister of Pakistan, who had flown to Washington to try to find a face-saving way out of the crisis, a way that he could pull back from this conflict because the United States was going to help him mediate this. President Clinton did not want to reward him for starting this aggression, but he also wanted to avoid nuclear war. So what he did is he confronted the Prime Minister of Pakistan and said, do you realize how close you are to this? Do you realize what would happen if this continues and there's a miscalculation? And it shocked the Prime Minister enough that he was able to walk him back. So Clinton certainly took this seriously. He also did have a little fun with it, inadvertently in some cases. One day he told me he opened up his president's daily brief and he started reading story after story about countries all around the world that were having crises. And those crises were directly linked to things that President Clinton himself had said and done in the previous days and weeks. And after getting through a few articles, it finally hit him. This is a fake PDB. They have written, for my birthday, it was his 50th birthday, they have written a fake book just to give me a laugh. Yeah. Of course, he also got the real one minutes later. After that came George W. Bush, the first president to be the son of a president who was the CIA director, vice president, and president. So no surprise that he comes into office and brings back in that daily rigorous intelligence briefing schedule. In fact, President Bush took the briefings up a notch in two different ways. First of all, instead of just taking a daily intelligence briefing with the president's daily brief, when he was in Washington, he started taking his briefer with him wherever he was traveling. If he was out of town domestically or overseas, when he was supposed to be getting the president's daily brief, he wanted the briefer to be in his entourage so that he could have that daily discussion with the briefer. One of those briefers, Michael Morell, was with him on 9/11, ended up flying around with him all day during the events on that horrible day. The second way in which he took it up a notch is Bush actually added something to the president's daily brief process. Instead of just getting these top secret intelligence reports every day in the book and reading through them and talking to the briefer, he decided he could use a little bit more. And that's a little surprising because this happened in his second term. And you may recall that when it comes to foreign policy and national security, the second term of the Bush administration had some major challenges involving a country called Iraq. And the analysis in the book was not the kind of thing that you hope to hear when you've invested a lot of energy into a policy to try to resolve the insurgency and then the civil war in this country. It was relentlessly negative, pointing out all the things that were going wrong. A normal human reaction would be, I don't want to hear that anymore. Please, stop. George W. Bush went the other direction. He said, I need more of that. I need more intelligence to find a way out. So he added to the regular president's daily brief sessions, he added what were called deep dives, where a few times each week, he would have world-class experts from the Central Intelligence Agency and eventually other intelligence agencies come in to meet with him and a few senior advisors for 30, 40 minutes to talk about very narrow, specific topics, to really dig into the intelligence, to figure out what the best application of this intelligence was so he could use it to make better decisions. Now we get up to our current president, Barack Obama. Barack Obama has made one significant change to the PDB, and it's a change in format that's a little bit fun. Throughout all of its history, the president's daily brief was printed ink on paper. Not anymore. The president's daily brief is electrons on a screen. President Obama gets his on an iPad. Now, don't fool yourself. This is not the same iPad that you have at home. It's a very special iPad without some of the security vulnerabilities that, unfortunately, ours have. But it does allow some interesting things. It allows the president to not only get text, but to get interactive graphics and videos, different ways of visualizing intelligence information to help reduce the uncertainty inherent in national security decisions. Another thing that has happened in the Obama administration is the number of recipients for the president's daily brief has grown. This has been something that has grown and shrunk over time. Some presidents have limited the president's daily brief to just themselves and one or two other advisors. Most presidents have included a core group of the vice president, the national security advisor, secretaries of state and defense, perhaps a White House chief of staff and a chairman of the Joint Chiefs of Staff, and then a few others might trickle in any particular administration. Barack Obama has expanded it to more than two dozen recipients. And that's a good thing and a bad thing. Depends on how you feel about it. On the one hand, if you're going to talk about the contents of the president's daily brief with a wider circle of advisors, what a great idea to expand it to more people, because then you get more advantage from it. On the other hand, the more people that receive this most exclusive document in the history of the world, the less sensitive information can go into it. And you end up having to go to the president more often, one-on-one in a discussion in the Oval Office, saying, here's the super sensitive thing that we didn't want printed, and going to 30 people. So that's one change that has happened that has engendered some debate and discussion. The themes of the president's daily brief, the themes of presidential intelligence delivered over the past 60 years have been fascinating as I've looked into this. First of all, every president seems to have appreciated intelligence in one form or another. Richard Nixon is at one end of the spectrum. His direct interaction with the president's daily brief was probably minimal. But through his discussions every single day with Henry Kissinger, sometimes dozens of times a day, he was getting the intelligence information because Kissinger himself was so up to speed on it and so well briefed. At the other extreme, you have people like the Bushes, who had the daily interaction with the CIA officers as part of their process. The other change we've seen, of course, is that the intelligence community is much wider and more integrated now. Since the events of 9/11, there's been the creation of the Office of the Director of National Intelligence, who oversees all of the intelligence agencies. Now, the President's Daily Brief is produced by that office, not just by the CIA, allowing officers from all of the intelligence agencies to contribute to the President's Daily Brief to help inform the President about the various national security issues of the day. I'm going to stop there because I'm really interested in what you're interested in, and I'd like to hear your questions about the various presidents and the various changes in presidential intelligence over the years. I'll share with you some of the stories from the book and then point you to some others that you can read later if you want to. Thank you very much.
Thank you, David. David has agreed to answer your questions, but I first want to announce that he'll be out in the lobby to sign your books, so they're available for purchase out there, and he'll be happy to meet every one of you. I'd like to start Q&A by asking, you've read about and analyzed the presidents, you've seen the daily briefs throughout the decades since the Kennedy administration. Ideally, what do you think a presidential daily brief should look like?
Yeah, it sounds like a cop-out, but it is a simple answer. The president's daily brief should look like exactly what the sitting president wants it to look like. That does not mean the content should look like what the president wants it to look like. If the intelligence community is giving the president what the president wants to hear, they're failing. The job of intelligence is to tell the president what he needs to hear. Truth to power. Objective analysis of what's going on. But in terms of the format, in terms of what it should look like, it has to meet the needs of the sitting president. It's called the president's daily brief for a reason. It is brief. It's only a few pages instead of hundreds of pages. It is daily, but most importantly, it's the president's. And if it's not suiting the needs of that president, then it's not doing its job. I would say that all things equal, a briefing seems to make more sense than just reading the book, because a briefing gives you the opportunity to drill down, to ask about alternative explanations, to explore the information base behind the judgments within the book. So that's something that probably makes more sense. Then again, presidents don't get to the Oval Office without knowing their own learning style really well. And if there's a president who knows that he's a reader, President Obama appears to be in that case, and he's going to process information better by reading than by listening to people talk while he's reading, hard for us to second guess that.
We have a question in the fourth row. Please stand.
Is there something that's similar? I mean, this seems to be like it's mostly about foreign policy kind of things. Is there like a similar daily briefing type thing for domestic information?
Yep. Thank you. I have not found any evidence that there is a direct equivalent. But the White House Chief of Staff, part of that job is to make sure the president is prepared on everything that's going to hit the president's agenda that day. So whether it's a report on which congressmen are going to speak out against an initiative, whether it's a list of the meetings that are coming up and what the president needs to know to prepare. But there is no direct parallel to this report that is focused on national security and largely foreign policy.
Once the major political parties have selected their candidates, mm-hmm. do they receive a form of the PDB?
Yes. Timely question. In fact, Donald Trump has received one such campaign briefing, and Hillary Clinton is scheduled to, on Saturday, receive hers. Don't fool yourself. These are not the president's daily brief. There's really three gradations of briefings for people in that presidential process. First, as a candidate, There has been a custom since 1952, when Harry Truman offered to his two potential successors an informational briefing, giving an overview of global hotspots and information. It's a no-kidding classified briefing, but it does not contain intelligence sources and methods. It does not contain very specific information about things, certainly doesn't contain anything about covert action in it. It's more of an overview of things going on in the international arena. The purpose is twofold. One, and the original purpose with Harry Truman came into office when FDR died. He came into office not even knowing the Manhattan Project existed to create the atomic bomb. He was president of the United States in wartime, and he did not know the atomic bomb was in process. He did not want his successors to be as ill-prepared starting out, so he started the process for that reason. But it's really evolved over time. There's a second reason for it now, and that is because the candidates in a campaign aren't just talking about domestic policy. They're out there talking about various foreign policy issues as well. And whether it's in a campaign debate or out on the stump, it would be pretty easy for a candidate completely inadvertently to say something that would actually get in the way of a national security issue or to box themselves into something once in office. So to avoid that from happening, this custom has gone on for some 70 years. Now that changes dramatically after Election Day, because the custom, going back to the beginning of the PDB and its first transition with President Nixon, is that the sitting president offers the president's daily brief to the president-elect immediately after the election. We have a relatively short transition time if you think about all the things that hit a president's agenda as soon as they're inaugurated. And so they've done it by custom that the president of the United States offers that to the president-elect. One time in recent history, that's been a problem. The year 2000. We had an election and nobody knew who won. Now this was not a problem for one candidate because Vice President Al Gore was getting the president's daily brief every day already. Problem solved. Not so much for George W. Bush. And a CIA team had been put in place ready just in case he won, to be ready that next morning to deliver the book to him and get him involved. And they just sat there twiddling their thumbs for days and then weeks. And eventually they realized this cannot go on. If the election ends up going to Bush, we don't want to give him just a couple of weeks to prepare this. So for the first time in history, a sitting president allowed someone to start receiving the president's daily brief who wasn't even a president-elect, and George W. Bush started getting it even before the Florida recount was finished. Then, of course, as president, the president's daily brief is not only something you get, but it's something you truly call your own, and you can design it however you want, with white space or as an iPad. Thank you.
A question in the back row.
Hi. I have a question I have to ask. How many briefings, daily briefings, has President Obama missed?
It's an interesting question because if you're talking about briefings and whether they're scheduled and then you miss them, or whether you're talking about whether they were scheduled at all as briefings. President Obama does not always receive PDB briefings. The Director of National Intelligence right here yesterday was talking about the fact that President Obama reads his book and then several times a week, Director Clapper or one of his deputies will go in and talk to the president about the intelligence, usually supplementing what's in the book, because President Obama doesn't want to hear people read to him what he's already read. Instead, they'll talk about it or raise new issues. He doesn't see a briefer on a regular basis to talk about the actual items in the book. That part is definitely true. So his schedule does not have on it every day President's Daily Briefing, because he'll read it while eating breakfast. He'll read it while he's exercising on the treadmill. He'll read it in his office, but he doesn't need a schedule item for it. So it appears that he's not getting the president's daily brief. That part's not true. He is getting the president's daily brief, just not a dedicated briefing. But of course, you can still get the president's daily brief without having a scheduled briefing. I think back to Ronald Reagan. For 8 years, he received the president's daily brief, and you will not find a president's daily brief on his schedule because he did not see a working level CIA officer to brief him on the PDB. He read it, like President Obama does, he read it and discussed it with his advisors separately.
Question in the back row.
Yes, I'm curious, aside from you initially putting that book together for Kennedy, after that administration, I understand why you did it, the purpose behind it, putting that book together. Mm-hmm. But aside from the different, administrations with the presidents, I'm curious, why did they feel that it was so important? Was it because they wanted to more than just brief a president, maybe kind of weigh in on a decision on what a president would take stand on, or someone like Nixon who didn't react, he became non-reactive to that. I was just curious about that.
Yeah, let me get to a very important issue behind that question, behind the answer. Let me clarify, the president's daily brief, the intelligence assessments are intended to be objective analysis of what is actually going on in the world. That is a description of the situation in a particular country. They are not meant to be policy advice. They are not weighing in, as you said, on various policy issues. Intelligence, when it's well done, is scrupulously unbiased, non-political, and neutral. The ethics of the intelligence community is to call it like you see it. Well, you can't do that if you're trying to argue a political point. Sometimes you see the evidence and it adds up to something that you really don't want to see, something that disagrees with something you analyzed even the week before. The job of the intelligence analyst is to write the intelligence that the information suggests is the best assessment. Therefore, there is no weighing in on policy. Now, that's a different question from whether intelligence officers like to have access to the president. They do. They do. There's something hypnotic about the fact, knowing, whether it's as an intelligence analyst writing up an assessment of something, knowing that the next morning the president of the United States is going to read that and take a decision based on that. Not that it pushes him to a decision, but he's going to have to make a decision on that, and the intelligence analysis is going to help him reduce the uncertainty inherent in that decision. There is something hypnotic about having that kind of access. As a bureaucracy, there's also that feeling, and I describe in the book, in various administrations, the great efforts that the CIA in particular went to try to make sure that the president still liked them, because they did not like it when they found out that any given president was just not that into them. For President Clinton, they tried to get him back into the fold, into regular briefings, by developing what they called a first customer campaign, where they got stickers and buttons and pins, all to celebrate writing for the first customer, to energize analysts to put more energy into it. They even told Clinton about it. They went in and showed him the stickers and pins, and he just laughed, thought it was a really funny gimmick. But he did say that by the end of his administration, he thought the PDB had improved. So something there seems to have worked.
Question in the front row.
You have to, obviously, with so many things going on in the world on any given day, you have to be selective. You can't put everything in there. Can you recall or share with us any items that the CIA missed in the briefing that kind of blindsided some people, and maybe their reaction when they were blindsided?
Absolutely. I think it was Michael Hayden, a recent CIA director, who said, if it's a fact, it ain't intelligence. And that really gets to the nature of what's in these assessments. If it's something that is known, well, intelligence isn't that useful because it's already out there. Intelligence is trying to, in some cases, predict the unpredictable, to give insight into something that is unknown even to the people who are supposed to be doing it. I'll give examples of a coup. If there's going to be an attempted coup in a country, nobody has a more vested interest in knowing that than the person who's about to be overthrown, and the intelligence and the military services who are still loyal trying to protect it. If they don't know it's happening, it does seem a little unfair to say, well, the CIA should have its crystal ball and should know what those people are going to do even before they know they're going to do it. So there have been many spectacular failures on things like that, not predicting coups, not knowing exactly how an election is going to turn out, because there is no psychic input from every single voter knowing which lever they push. On the other hand, there's been a lot that has been predicted right, and there are some great cases in the book about that. The 1967 war between Israel and the Arab neighbors around it. The CIA analysis predicted that it probably would end within 7 days and became known as the Six-Day War. But that did not buy them a lot of credibility a few years later. The 1973 war between Israel and her neighbors, the very day that the invasion from Egypt started, the president's daily brief said that the exercises in Egypt were incredibly realistic, but there was no threat to Israel at this time. That's an embarrassing, a disastrous piece of analysis to have going to the president. The one thing that I saw, and the one thing that a lot of the people I talked to saw, was the Central Intelligence Agency, and now the intelligence community as a whole, are learning organizations. No one takes it harder when there's a missed analytic call on an important national security issue than an intelligence analyst. 9/11 is a huge case of this.
I know many, many people, including myself, who still think about that day and think, we were screaming off the rooftops, we were talking over and over again about the threat information we were getting, the lights were blinking red, we knew there was a major plot, but what more could we have done before that day to prevent that event? That still burns a lot of people, and it will for the rest of our lives. And we learn because of it. What can we do better? What can we do when we predict Iraq has weapons of mass destruction, and they really don't? What can we put into our process to make sure that the same mistake doesn't happen again? We would rather make all new mistakes than repeat the same ones again.
We have a question in the second row.
Well, you kind of stole my thunder, because I was going to ask you, there was a well-reported PDB from the George W. Bush administration.
Right.
I think it was in the spring of 2001, maybe?
August 2001.
It's the title, if I'm not mistaken, was Bin Laden Determined to Strike U.S.
Perfect.
So can you tell us any story behind that one?
I can. Yeah, I have the full story of that is in the book. I've talked to the analyst who wrote the piece and all the customers who received it. The analysis in the president's daily brief during that summer, the summer of threat before September 11th, there was lots of terrorism information going in there. But one thing that they felt hadn't been communicated to the president yet was not the capabilities of al-Qaeda. We knew al-Qaeda could blow things up. They'd done it to U.S. embassies. They'd done it to a U.S. naval vessel. But the intention of bin Laden and al-Qaeda. And so a piece was put out there that was bin Laden determined to strike in U.S., to put out there, we're looking all over the Middle East, we're looking all over Africa, but let's not lose sight on the fact that he has said publicly he wants to strike here. And we have other intelligence information indicating he wants to strike here. And that's what that piece was all about. Now, the piece got a whole lot of attention during the 9/11 Commission hearings because buried down at the bottom is a reference to hijacking of planes. Now, if you read it carefully, the hijacking of planes that's talked about there has nothing to do with the plot that actually happened. It was a separate intelligence stream. It was talking about hijacking a plane to free the release of a prisoner in the United States, which was so not the purpose of the 9/11 attacks. But it was the most scrutinized PDB in history. And in fact, that's probably when most Americans first heard of the president's daily brief, because it was getting that attention of what did the president know and when did he know it. Now, it's also important to remember, every day the president's daily brief might have 6, 8, or 10 articles on various countries around the world. And that's every single day. So there are going to be many, many articles like this warning of things that may happen or warning of things that may not happen because circumstances change on the ground.
A question to your right.
Yeah, I have a question. You said that Nixon and also President Obama do not want to rely on daily briefers, but rather on their advisors. Is there any choice that presidents have to select their daily briefers, or is the CIA totally independent, independently choosing those briefers?
Yeah, the selection of the briefers has changed over time. Initially, I'll go back to President Ford, the CIA selected a guy named Dave Peterson who they thought would appeal to President Ford. He was a Midwesterner like Gerald Ford. They thought their personalities would click, and so they proposed him and put him in front of Ford, and sure enough, they got along so well that he continued it when he was president, not just vice president. Other presidents, usually the CIA and now the Office of the Director of National Intelligence, nominates a briefer and puts them forward to the president. I did not find any cases in my research talking to the former presidents or those around them where a president decided to get a briefing and then saw the briefer that was offered and said, "Nah, no thanks, I've changed my mind." I didn't see any evidence of that. Part of that's because the people that are chosen for that level of briefing generally are pretty good at the job and know how to communicate well and not to annoy people. That's one of the primary bars you have to clear to be a briefer. But the other part of it is that the intelligence briefings themselves are not personality focused. The spotlight is not on the briefer. Trust me, it feels that way. You feel like the world depends on you every morning, but it really doesn't. It's about the information. The whole point of the briefer's job is to make sure that the customer that you're briefing understands the information and analysis in the president's daily brief every day. Not that they agree with it. That's not your job. You don't have to convince them that you're right. But you have to make sure that they understand what the argument is and what the assessment is. With that laser focus on the information itself, yeah, the briefer is important and the individual selected may matter. But a good briefer makes sure that it's not about them. It's about the relationship and it's about the material. Thank you.
A question right here.
Thank you very much. Two questions. One, are any of the briefings redone after they've been released by any of the recipients saying, could you change this? And secondly, I asked this question yesterday and didn't get an answer. How much does it cost to do this?
Let me ask you to clarify the first question. When you mean redone, do you mean the analysis is redone or that the policy
when the report is released to the president, let's say the morning or the evening before,
right.
is it ever redone after everyone has read it? And say, oh, please take this out or add this.
In one form, and then I'll try to get back to your issue of cost, or I'll ignore it if I can't come up with an answer like they did yesterday. When it comes to redoing the analysis, it's one of those yes and no answers. Absolutely. An issue that is put into the president's daily brief is almost always updated either the next day or later on when new information comes in. It is. Now, that's not a change to the original assessment. That is a record. That is what it is. And the great thing about this public declassification and release of all of these documents from the 1960s and 1970s, you get to see what the president saw that morning. You get to see on any particular day what it was that President Nixon, in this case, was reading. That is a record. Now, you will also see threads through the PDB over days, over weeks, many cases over years. You will see the analysis. It's a storyline. On one day, we knew this. We presented this to the president. A week later, we got new information, and we said, that thing we said, not so true anymore. In fact, we think it's this. And then something came in to supplement that, and you just add to the process as it goes through. So there is constantly a reexamination of the evidence when new information comes in or when other things happen in the world that affect that situation. On the issue of cost, the answer you got was both dissatisfying and completely and totally honest. I don't know a way to put a cost on the president's daily brief, because on the one hand, everyone in the intelligence community can contribute to it, and at some level does contribute to it, because the expertise they're building, the work they're doing briefing other customers, writing for other products, when it's their turn to write for the president, all of that feeds into it. So you could say that the vast majority of every career of every intelligence officer in every agency could be attributed to the president's daily brief, because eventually that expertise will come to bear for the president when that issue hits the front burner. On the other hand, not everybody in the intelligence community writes for the PDB every day. Very few do. There's only a few articles in it every day. A few people coordinate or help the author with the piece, and then some managers look at it and review it, and some editors look at it before it goes downtown. So there is a finite number of people who work on it. And then, of course, there's the cost of the actual production, which, in the grand scheme of things, is not nearly as much as the cost of world-class experts covering 197 countries and many transnational issues around the world. So I think it is fair of them to say we don't know what the cost is. I also think that depending on how you define it, you could have an astronomical number that would blow you away and as a taxpayer be offended by, or you could have a number thinking, if this gives the president advantage on decisions to preempt threats and to take advantage of opportunities, and it only costs that number of people to produce that article that day, that's a pretty good investment for the American people.
I have a question towards the back.
Yeah, I was going to ask you, have you found in your research, is there any correlation between the people who are assigned to do the briefings or the briefing teams that being groomed for further things? Are these your future directors you're going to see in 10, 15, 20 years? Is that kind of, they're putting forward their candidate earlier?
There is a relationship, and not all senior intelligence officials who came up through the bureaucracy were briefers. In part, that's because traditionally a lot of the intelligence briefers were from the analysis side of the house. These are the people who take all of the inputs from all of the foreign intelligence collection and then say, here's what it means. Here's what the picture looks like when we only have some of the puzzle pieces. And so those are the briefers, but there's a whole other side to CIA, the Directorate of Operations, which does a lot of the foreign intelligence collection and covert action. There's also directorates of support and science and technology and digital innovation. Traditionally, they haven't written the analysis as much. So the leaders who rise to the top of the CIA who come from those other directorates tend not to have briefing experience. But a whole lot of the senior leaders within the analysis directorate and the ones like a Michael Morell, who became deputy director and acting director, John Brennan, who became director of the CIA, a whole lot of them were briefers. And that makes sense because that has insight into the relationship between intelligence and policy at the highest level. which is really useful for somebody who's running an organization of experts.
We have a question in the center.
Oh, first of all, thank you very much for being here tonight.
Thank you.
Two-part question. Do you think our administration knew about the coup about to happen in Turkey? Mm-hmm. And the second part is, were we involved in it?
Next question. No. The second question I have no insight on. I won't even pretend to try. The first one I can give you some insight on, not on the exact question of Turkey, because I'm not seeing the president's daily brief every day. It still is only a small number of people who are. But I'll tell you about my experience with things like predicting coups and getting ahead of situations that surprised, became breaking news on CNN. On any given day, there were things in the president's daily brief that I would come in the early hours of the morning, because the briefings usually start the customer's day at 6:30, 7, 8 o'clock. So that means as a briefer, you go into the office at 2 or 3 in the morning. Horrible job. Great job, but a horrible job. You come in early in the morning and you see the draft president's daily brief. In many days, I would open it up and I would see some assessment based on some exquisite intelligence collection we had about what some bad actor was doing overseas that was going to harm US citizens, or about what some foreign government was planning on doing. And I would just, my jaw would drop. And I would think, that's why we do this. That's why we have this expensive and very difficult in a democracy enterprise of intelligence. And then some days I would come in at 2 or 3 in the morning and I would open the book and I would say, are you kidding me? This is all we got? This doesn't really add anything. I listened to the radio on the way in, and this doesn't move us much farther than this. And the funny thing was, on any given day, I couldn't tell the difference. It wasn't always true that it was a particular topic and not another, or it was based on a particular where in the policy arc this story was. There was a loose correlation, and that is on the societies and the issues that were least open to the press and other sources, the intelligence information was amazing. And you can imagine the places, like North Korea and others, where good intelligence sources will actually give the president something that he or she does not know any other way and enable action that otherwise is not possible. And then you can imagine many other countries around the world where they have an open press, democracy, lots of sources of information, where the advantage being provided by clandestine collection is probably smaller, and the analysis in the book probably looks a whole lot like what you'd see in a pretty good news magazine. But on some days, I was surprised either way, when sometimes you would see something like the prediction of a coup. I thought, huh, that's funny, because we don't see any signs that it's happening any other way. Oh, yeah, we're that good today. And then sometimes where I'd see something in the book, I'd say, how come we're not getting ahead of an issue? That's the nature of intelligence. It ain't a crystal ball. Hopefully it gives decision advantage to a policymaker, giving them that little bit of foreknowledge on major issues, but it's not always going to be perfect.
Thank you, David.
Thank you.
Please give David Priess a round of applause.